On This Week in Enterprise Tech, Dropbox boots Windows XP, we talk a little bit about encryption and everything you needed to know about phone fraud. Twyatt on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Twyatt. This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 186. Recorded April 22nd, 2016. Death, taxes, fraud, and Pindrop. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by Igloo Software. Igloo is an internet you'll actually like. It connects people with the information they need to do their best work. Try it for free at igloosoftware.com/twit or sign up for a live demo to see it in action. And by Things Canary. Detect attackers or malicious insiders on your network with honeypots that can be deployed in minutes. For 10% off and a 60-day money-back guarantee, go to canary.tools/twit and enter the code TWIT in the How Did You Hear About Us box. Welcome to Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. But I don't guide you by myself. I've got my my friends backing me up, starting with Mr. Brian Chee. He's the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Brian, how are you, my friend?
Gromit and I are doing fine, and I just packed up my boxes with the kitchen sink in it and sent them off to Interop.
That's right. Actually, I think the three of us are going to be in Vegas at the same time. We may have to do... I'm thinking I want to take you to Shellfish. I know that you'll die, but I've got an EpiPen, so it'll be all good.
Well, we have fresh EpiPens, so that's all good.
Fantastic. Now, speaking of the three, the third of the three, wow, starting to sound like an episode of Charmed, is Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, how are things on the other coast, and are you done running for now?
Done running for the moment. Finished the Dark Side 5K and 10K, and now I get to start practicing and... learning how to stretch my distance for next year, but Florida is giving me nice warm weather to do that.
Well, gentlemen, we've got a great episode. Not only will we talk a little bit about the latest and the greatest in the enterprise world, but we've also bringing back an old friend, a man who wowed the Twyatt audience with technology that could look for acoustic fraud in your phone system. He's going to be talking about death, taxes, and fraud. But before we do that, let's go ahead and jump into the blips. Now, when is a financial quarter both a smashing success and a sobering failure? Well, evidently it is if you're Microsoft. The Redmond giant absolutely freaked out Wall Street with a lower than expected earning for the first quarter of 2016. Non-GAAP profit was $5 billion on $22.1 billion of revenue, or $3.8 billion GAAP profit on $20.5 billion, amounting to 47 cents or 62 cents earnings per share. That's a 25% drop off from the first quarter of 2015. Also, year over year sales were down $1.2 billion to $20.5 billion, and Windows consumer sales were up 15 while enterprise was down 11. That's the sobering failure. At least a little of that disappointing quarter can be attributed to the stronger dollar pushing down forward in sales, something that also hit Google in the first quarter of 2016. But while those numbers were definitely down, Microsoft absolutely killed it in the cloud. Office 365 sales grew 6%, and its subscriber base almost doubled from a year ago, from 12.4 million to 22.2 million. Azure and server sales jumped 120% from 2015, and even Xbox grew, with monthly active users growing 26% to 46 million. In all, with its cloud-based offerings offsetting weaknesses elsewhere, this quarter may be remembered as a turning point for Microsoft, from the company it was to the company it wants to be.
Amazon expands choices and services at the AWS Summit. Amazon Web Services got bigger this week, expanding the storage options available with Elastic Block Storage and adding Amazon Inspector and S3 Data Accelerator to its list of offerings. In announcements at its AWS Summit in Chicago, Amazon led with the Amazon Inspector, a security assessment service that can be applied to a customer's future Amazon workload while it's still under development on the customer's premises. Designed to build better security into agile development, Amazon Inspector should help reduce design flaws that lead to vulnerability. In addition, S3 Data Accelerator means Snowball got much faster and EC2 got cheaper. So the march to make everything Amazon keeps moving right along.
Well, our predictions keep coming true, and this time it's a cancer center's 2.2 million patients. It seems 21st Century Oncology recently got breached and upwards of 2.2 million former and current patient records were exposed. This on the heels of Hollywood Presbyterian's battle with ransomware. What we really need to keep in mind is that healthcare isn't necessarily less careful than other enterprises, but rather a juicier target with potentially greater risks. The bottom line is that security can't be an afterthought for anyone.
Well, here's a shocker. We just can't shut down the internet. A hot topic in IT is global security in an age where the internet can provide almost completely anonymous communications. So perhaps it's not surprising that at a Senate hearing on the fiscal 2017 budget for U.S. Cyber Command, Senator Joe Manchin of West Virginia asked Cyber Commander Admiral Mike Rogers, why can't we just shut down that part of the internet, unquote. To his credit, Admiral Rogers took the question seriously and tried to explain why the internet isn't the same as a telephone line. But it does once again raise the question, shouldn't our elected officials who are in charge of legislating tech policy have at least a rudimentary understanding of the tech that they're legislating? With both Republican and Democratic presidential candidates having recently suggested closing up the internet to combat terrorism, it might be time for the digital generation to rise up and be heard. Or just to turn on encryption on everything.
Speaking of encryption, Opera now comes with a free VPN. Just when you thought the browser wars were over, well, they might still be, but they just got a little more interesting courtesy of Opera, which is adding a virtual private network component for its desktop web browser. The component uses is what users will make use of to access region-restricted websites and shield their browsing choices when utilizing public Wi-Fi networks. The free VPN client, which offers unlimited data usage and 256-bit encryption, is available as part of Opera's newest developer version of its browser. All users, though, can select the activation option from the Opera settings menu. In the developer release, users can choose from one of three virtual locations in the U.S., Canada, and Germany, but the company said more locations will be available in the stable GA version of the Opera browser.
Well, why is an underwriter laboratory willing to share their standard for IoT cybersecurity? So let's get this correct. UL is willing to share, but for a fee, as Ars Technica found out. It seems UL isn't interested in making the world safer, but making more bucks. My opinion is that standards should be open and be a goal for manufacturers to meet, then pay UL to confirm they actually meet those standards. Hey, Padre, maybe my lab should be doing their own standards and making it public through the IEEE or IETF. What do you think?
I'm actually pretty good with that, Chiebert. You know what? I'm not good, though. I'm not good with people trying to take away the things I love. Like, for example, you can have my Windows XP when you pry it from my cold, dead Dropbox. Which, as it turns out, is now. Dropbox has announced that they will end support for Windows XP on June 26th. After that date, you will no longer be able to download a version of Dropbox for XP, and users will be prevented from signing in to existing accounts even if they kept an older version of the client. On August 29th, even those XP users who were already signed in before the deadline will be cut off from the system. Dropbox says that they're making the move because its new features won't be compatible with XP. Additionally, insiders have recognized that persistent sign-on on an OS that is ripe for exploitation is not a good way to protect users' data. XP Dropbox users will still be able to access their files through the web client, but with more and more software makers like Chrome declining to support the aging OS, maybe it's time to switch already? That does it for the Blix. Next up, we've got some bites. We're going to do a deep dive on your privacy, on your security, and, of course, the Internet of Things. But first, let's go ahead and take a moment to thank the first sponsor of the Twilight Right. And I'm going to start with a question. Hey, Enterprise folks, it's 2016, so why in the world are you using an intranet that was created back in the 90s? Now, sure, it was nice back in the day, giving you what you needed to do business at the time. But today, that once slick internet is painfully stale and ugly. And most likely, you can't access it unless you're at work. And that's why we're so happy to have Igloo as a supporter of the Twilight Riot. Now, Igloo is an internet that you'll actually like. It's a cloud portal that enables you to share files, collaborate on documents, blog updates, coordinate calendars, and manage projects all from the same attractive and intuitive interface. Igloo leverages the best part of an intranet, important enterprise-specific data at your fingertips, and what people have come to expect from the internet. Igloo gives your users comments, like buttons, and the ability to add content based on their permissions with drag-and-drop widgets and a WYSIWYG editor. Of course, a beautiful and intuitive interface isn't very useful if your users can't access it on the devices that they're using. And that's why Igloo is built with a responsive design. It automatically reformats to your phone or your tablet, your laptop, or your desktop. It's also customizable. This is really important. SharePoint, Salesforce, Active Directory, and soon Dropbox, those are tools that you have already. Well, with Igloo, they can live inside the software, inside the service, and it can have your look and feel, your brand. That's important if you want to grow your business. How about security? Well, how about SSL and 256-bit encryption baked into a variety of access, authentication, and identity services to ensure that only authorized users have access to your system? And unlike other solutions, you get full access to Igloo's entire suite of tools, all for one price. Volume pricing is also available, and it's used by the U.S. government, by government agencies, and companies like Hulu, Inventive Health, American Family Insurance, and Ipswich. Folks, if you're not using Igloo, you're just working too hard. Sign up now and try it for free at igloosoftware.com/twit. That's igloosoftware.com/twit. And when you sign up through our link, you can get your own Igloo for up to 10 people absolutely free for as long as you want. That's igloosoftware.com/twit. And we thank Igloo for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Let's go ahead and jump into the bites. This one may get a little bit ranty. That's a forewarning. Now, the past few months have seen a marked interest in encryption technology and policy, mostly sparked by Apple's refusal to comply with the FBI and the DOJ in breaking into the security on an iPhone that was used by one of the San Bernardino terrorists. Unfortunately, most of the discussion has really been a yelling match. Tech companies and advocates have been decrying government overreach, and law enforcement and government have been saying, basically, if you're not with us, then you support the terrorist. Chibert, let me open this up with you, because we kind of shied away from this. We talked about it once, but there was so much high temper on the line that we didn't want to jump into it until people maybe took a step back. Are we now ready to talk about encryption in a way that doesn't make it sound as if either you're a terrorist or you're patriotic?
Well, I think it's high time we have this conversation, but I keep getting disappointed in my congressional delegations at how poorly educated they are on the encryption topic. You know, we've got people that are making some really interesting, entertaining statements that is very, very clear they don't understand the topic. So, yes, it's time. But is it the right people? That's my big question.
And actually, that's a very good point. And Curtis, I'm going to throw this over to you, because now we have a glimmer of hope with the new encryption controversy. We're kind of done with Apple and the FBI, and they've paid some obscene amount of money to break into that phone. But there is currently a draft bill. It's a draft bill in the Senate. It's a bipartisan bill created by a Republican senator by the name of Richard Burr and California Democrat Dianne Feinstein that would require tech companies that build encryption and digital protection into their products to break said protection in case law enforcement ever came calling. Now, if enacted, the bill would require companies to provide any requested data in a, quote, intelligible format, unquote, or provide technical assistance to convert data into that said intelligible format. The bill is still in draft form, and it does provide financial compensation for companies that are affected, and it does not yet spell out any penalties for non-cooperation, nor does it mention the use of unbreakable encryption that was developed outside of the United States. But already we're seeing a big pushback. There was a petition with over 34,000 people signing it saying, look, this is ridiculous. We had an open letter from several tech giants that basically said, look, we want to help you, but this ain't the way to do it. Curtis, Senator, what's his name? I'm sorry, the Republican Senator Richard Burr did say, in a way, kind of backing off after all this pushback, that this was a way to spark discussion. Is this discussion the discussion that we're looking for? Is this the format of the discussion that we need?
Well, I think it's definitely a discussion that we need outside the confines and context of a lawsuit or an active investigation. So to the extent that this is a conversation that can happen in the context of legislation rather than a court proceeding, I think that's good. Because court proceedings are inherently adversarial. There is no way to take a reasoned middle ground in a court proceeding. Either going for a win on one side or the other. But in a, ideally, at least, and in a functional republic, in the legislative process, there's room for all kinds of compromise. And compromise is exactly what we need, because there are competing interests here. On the one hand, you have the interests of everyone who is transacting financial or other private data operations via the public internet. And for all of those people, strong, if you will, unbreakable encryption is critical. On the other hand, you have the legitimate concern of law enforcement, who will occasionally, and with the supervision of the courts, want to have access to some data that is being transacted via the internet. So weighing those competing interests is exactly what the legislature should be doing. But as you mentioned early, it's much easier for them to do that if they have some clue about what's going on. And unfortunately, what they tend to do is listen to those who have strong interest on one side or the other, and who tend to oversimplify things to a degree that makes them absolutely meaningless. We've seen that before, and I wish I were far more confident that it's not going to happen now.
Yeah, actually, you bring up a really good point in saying that there is no compromise in a courtroom. You have a decision one way or the other, and unfortunately, people are conflating a judgment with a precedent. And a lot of times we have a judgment that's not supposed to set a precedent, or we have a precedent that's not necessarily a judgment. I think, and this is what gives me hope, I think we might be heading into a phase of this discussion where people are actually willing to listen. Again, I did mention that there was an open letter that was signed by a large group of tech giants, including Microsoft, Apple, Google, Facebook, Twitter, Netflix, the Internet Infrastructure Coalition, and pretty much all the big players in this space. They did send an open letter to both Burr and Feinstein, and yes, it did criticize the bill, but it was much more tempered. It was more debate and less liar, liar, pants on fire, which I think is what we've heard the last 3 months. They were very clear in pointing out what they called the unintended negative consequences for the safety of our networks and our customers. In fact, I want to read a quote here. This is from midway through the letter. They said, quote, "The bill would force those providing digital communications and storage to ensure that digital data can be obtained in intelligible form by the government pursuant to the court order. This mandate would mean that when a company or user has decided to use some encryption technologies, those technologies will have to be built to allow some third party to potentially have access. In this access could in turn be exploited by bad actors." And I think that really sums up the worst case scenario, which is no matter how well-intended you might be, and no matter how many times you say that you're not asking for a backdoor, you are asking for a backdoor, and it will be exploited. Chiebert, let me throw this to you. You have senators who are very, very careful to avoid using backdoor or special access for the government. But then you've got the tech companies who are saying, look, what you're asking for, even though you're not outright saying we want a way in past all the encryption, that's the only way that we can say that we would be able to meet this law. This is the only way that we would be able to provide you support to return the data to intelligible access. So is the government asking for a backdoor or not?
Well, the government certainly is. What I'd propose to those senators is add another third party. So right now we've got the tech companies who build the technology, the government that wants the information, maybe we should go and add in people like the financial world, the people that are risk adverse and are famous for finding compromises. Maybe those are the people that need to mediate this war. But yeah, they're totally asking for a backdoor, no matter what they call it. And it's like, what are you going to do? You know, we've seen how well master keys work, you know, with TSA showing them on TV. I don't like the concept of backdoors at all, but I also don't like the concept of terrorists. And I would like to see the government, I'd like to see the tech companies, and maybe the people that have probably the biggest risk in the game from the backdoor of encryption is the financial world. And maybe those three would be a better combination to hammer out a real compromise that has the least amount of problems.
Right. And we don't see much of that. We do see a lot, and there's actually some outrage in the chat room, of Congress legislating what they don't understand, or tech companies spouting off when they don't really understand policy. And, you know, Chiebert, you've added in that third. If you want to talk about encryption, if you want to talk about why we have encryption, why we have security, there is no better example than the financial world. It seems as if at some point, if this open letter is genuine, the tech companies seem to be saying, look, tell us what you actually want. Don't couch it. Don't make it politically correct. Don't try to sell it to your voters. Tell us what access you need. Tell us what you're doing to make sure you're protecting the guaranteed rights of the citizens that will be affected. And then we will help you actually create a legislative solution that matches up with the tech solution. Curtis, is there any precedent for that happening, for that kind of cooperation?
Well, you know, yes, there is precedent for cooperation in the kind of things that, for example, the telephone companies did to enable data gathering by law enforcement. And some of that happened a long time ago. Some of it's more recent. But all of it happened in an era that was different from our current era in one critical way. When it happened with the telecoms, there was a much greater trust of government in a couple of important ways. One was the motive of government, that government would, in fact, only use this in ways that a judge had overseen properly, where they were looking for real information from a real suspect and not simply trawling through vast quantities of data just to see if they could find something. The other important way is that in that era, government was trusted to be a safe steward of the data. In other words, if the police got hold of a recording of someone's phone calls, it was pretty likely that the recording would not wind up in the hands of that individual's enemies or the press. Unfortunately, in the past 2 or 3 years, we have seen multiple occasions when the government's safeguard of information has been far less than complete. And so I think the real, if you will, elephant in the room of the discussion is the basic trust of the government. And in these regards, in both the motivation and in their simple safe handling of data, the government has a lot of work to do, and so far it seems to have been much more willing to spend its time and effort on lawsuits and name-calling than in rebuilding that vital trust that it needs to have in order for a truly useful compromise to take place.
I want to go on a little aside here, because actually it is worthwhile. We have Emily the Strange, who asked a very good question, which is, Why are we demanding that our representatives know about technology just because they're making technology laws, in the sense that they don't know about medical care and they write laws about medical care? They don't know about airplanes, but they write laws about aviation. And Chiebert did make a very good point, which is, if you actually look at the history of bills that have been introduced by our representatives, many of those bills have come straight from lobbyist groups, and both the airline industry and the medical industry and most every other industry has a very big lobby that is not shy about supplying pre-written bills to representatives who then add their own little spin. It does happen in the tech industry, but we don't have it nearly to the same extent. And you see it clearly anytime they try to do something like this, encryption bill, which anyone who has even a little bit of knowledge about encryption and about how communications technology works will look at it and say, that's untenable. That would be like you legislating that airplanes cannot go more than 1,000 feet off the ground. You wouldn't do that, of course. So, let's get off of this before we get ranty, because we do have one more story that we want to cover before we get to our guest. Chiebert, I want to put you in the driver's seat on this one, because let's talk a little bit about the internet of rolling things.
Oh, yeah. So forget about Amazon's Prime Air drones. We're actually starting to already see self-driving wheeled delivery vehicles. In fact, the show right before us actually had some video from that, which is pretty cool. It's basically self-driving delivery vehicles aren't just George Jetson. You know, we've got a little guy done by a company called, Starship. They're an Estonian company, and if we could go to that video or that webpage, it's about the size of an ice chest. And it's a little six-wheeled robot. It's already rolling around London and Estonia, and apparently they're just starting trials in Washington, D.C. So as some other people have said, it is lockable. You can't break it open easily. You have to have some sort of code indicating that you are the customer. And they also have alarms and so forth. And this is all done by the people that brought us Skype. Now, in addition, Daimler, we were actually going through the website now, is got a toolkit. It's not specific to their trucks. It is basically a system that is designed to be added to just about any wheeled vehicle. And it kind of ties into a lot, you know, what Australia does. If you've ever driven through the outback in Australia, one of the things you'll notice is there are things called land trains. And it's this huge string of trucks. It might be two or three large trailers, 40-foot trailers. And they go roaring across the outback. And there's a lot of accidents because it's a really long, straight, boring drive. But nobody wants to build actual physical trains on tracks. It doesn't make sense for Australia. So automated driving makes a lot of sense. Now, when we really start getting into this, we've got Australians also using large dump trucks to move around, but in open pit mining. But those are human exclusion zones. So there's nobody to get squished by these giant trucks. But now, once we start putting things onto our sidewalks, like the Starship, or our public streets, like automated driving Daimler trucks or whatever, what are the issues? We've already seen a fender bender between a Google self-driving car and a bus. What's going to start happening as we start getting, you know, bigger incidents with large trucks? You know, what happens, you know, if someone cuts in? You know, we all have had some of these idiot drivers that just cut in at the last moment and cut across you as they suddenly realize they've almost missed the off-ramp. So there's a lot of issues. And so what I wanted to start talking about is let's actually delve into a little bit on predictions. What kinds of problems do you think we're going to start having? Because this is also going to drive the internet of really big things as distribution companies start thinking, let's cut down on my cost of moving things from warehouses to stores. Kind of cool. So I'm going to throw this to Curtis to talk about the enterprise side. What are the logistics? What are the issues that you think might be popping up that we should probably think about before these trucks start hitting the streets?
Well, I'm going to say that I think one of the things we need to keep in mind, and one of the things that I believe a lot of companies will keep in mind, is physics. You know, this is a conversation I had with a Ford engineer at CES in January when we talked about this very issue. We were talking about the fact that they had a Ford Fusion there on the show floor that they were using as a test mule for their autonomous driving effort. And I jokingly asked him when we were going to see the self-driving Ford F-350 dually crew cab. And he basically said there are physics problems. The heavier the vehicle, the longer it takes to do anything. And so I believe that from a corporate point of view, these small autonomous vehicles are going to be things that we see much more of. As a matter of fact, let me throw out what I think could be the perfect test scenario and test location for these smaller vehicles. It happens to be the fastest growing municipality in the United States, and it has been for the past 2 or 3 years. It's a place here in Florida called The Villages. It was begun as a retirement community, and one of the characteristics of The Villages, which is, by the way, a collection of little town centers all together, it has something like 125 or 130,000 people living there. But they have most of their areas where the residents don't have to use cars to get around. They can get everywhere they need to go in golf carts. And their residents do precisely that. Well, these are older individuals, and as part of aging in place, it wouldn't surprise me to see autonomous vehicles that make deliveries to their home using vehicles that are golf cart sized or smaller. All it would take would be laying some tracks, some navigational ribbons, or putting navigational beacons in. The communications could easily be taken care of in the infrastructure of The Villages, and the physics work. So while we are talking about the Internet of larger things, I truly believe that from the enterprise standpoint, we're going to see the Internet of slightly larger things before we see the Internet of truly gargantuan things on general public roadways.
Hey, Padre, you used to live in D.C. What do you think? How would the D.C. folks react to seeing a little six-wheeled ice cooler rolling around on the sidewalks? Don't we already have problems with Segways and skateboards and bicycles enough already in D.C.?
There are much stranger things in D.C. than roving ice coolers. So, it would be a curiosity for a while, but not that much longer than that. It is interesting because every time we talk about this, there's always I will be receiving emails after the show. I know, because people are saying, wait a minute, you're talking about cars now. Cars are not enterprise technology. And it's weird because, yes, now they are. Because they are so connected, because they do depend on so much big data analytics that have been done and is still being done in real time. And because they do depend on a type of communication that originated with enterprise development, that the networks that we're talking about for Chiebert's Internet of Gargantuan thing and Curtis's Internet of Slightly Bigger Things are really just an extension of what we've learned about building enterprise networks over the past 30 years. Chiebert, what I would think is people will be freaked out by this technology until they start to see the concrete advantages that it grants them. The very first time someone is drunk and has their car take them home autonomously, they're going to say, okay, yeah, that was worth it. The very first time that someone gets a drink from a robotic cooler that was just around the corner and they summoned it on their phone, they're going to say, okay, yeah, this is good. And all those concerns go away. A question I might actually have for you, Chiebert, is perhaps better suited for this would be something like Hawaii, something like an island, something like an isolated area that doesn't have many resources past its own boundaries. Could you see something like an autonomous road system taking place of that really crazy, expensive, and very controversial public rail system that you're currently installing?
Yeah, and they're actually now talking about having our rail system stop short of the big shopping centers. So they're talking about chopping it in half. It's getting so expensive that, yeah, it makes a lot of sense. There's been one of the big opponents of the fixed rail system in Hawaii was talking about, well, why don't we just go and have dedicated roadways for buses? Maybe we should have dedicated roadways for autonomous vehicles. You know, there's already a few running around. I think it's in Austria, where they're little, like, four-person cars, and they roll by themselves on trackways to get people around the airport. I can see experiments like that happening and then eventually going further. To directly answer your question, Hawaii is actually a really bad place for this because we have so little land. The main corridor between, you know, along the island is actually very narrow. So having dedicated area to anything always comes up and gets a lot of people very upset. Now, I could see this really working well for, say, the triangle area of Texas, you know, the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and having, you know, some dedicated area to move cargo back and forth. I think autonomous cargo delivery is going to be the sweet spot. And as part of the supply chain, it's totally enterprise.
I, for one, welcome our pizza-delivering overlords. Gentlemen, let's go ahead and move on because we do have a great guest. We've had him on the show before, Mr. Vijay Balasubramaniyan. He is the CEO of Pindrop. Now, you may remember them. About a year ago, they were guests here on Twite, and they explained how their technology was able to actually forecast an attack on your enterprise's phone tree using some very interesting software and a couple of algorithms that they created. A year before that, we saw them at Black Hat, where we were first introduced to their technology. Well, today they're going to come back to tell us about how they're able to spot fraud, specifically fraud related to telephone scams and your taxes. But before we do that, let's go ahead and thank another sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Let me ask you, you probably think that the worst thing that could happen to your company is a breach, right? I mean, that's what we all think. You lose that valuable information, maybe your transaction data, maybe your customer's information. God forbid you lose confidential corporate secrets to your competitors, and then you're done. You're just gone. Just go ahead and close the doors. We often think that a breach is the worst thing that can happen, but it's not. So you see, the worst thing that could happen is the breach that you don't know about, the breach that keeps happening, the breach that goes on until it's too late to do anything about it. And that's why we're happy to have Thinkst Canary as a part of the Twite Riot. Now, Canary is a honeypot. It's a way to trick attackers into revealing their techniques, their vectors of exploitation, and what they're looking for on your network. You sprinkle a few of them on your network. You make one look like a router. Another one looks like an unprotected Windows file share. A third as an IoT device. You can even enroll them in Active Directory so that your attackers don't think that they're just vulnerable. They think they're valuable. Now, they can be set up in as little as 4 minutes, and then you just sit back and wait for your canaries to start singing. You get a single alert when your canaries identify a verified attack. This is important, as alert fatigue from hundreds or even thousands of false positives are a great way to miss the real threats, the real attacks. Thinkst, the company behind Canary, has been in the security game for almost 2 decades. They've trained countless companies, militaries, and governments on how to break into networks, and Thinkst used that experience to build Canary. Now, you're probably thinking that security like this is going to cost way too much, but the beauty of the Canary is that you can start with just a few of them, then scale up as your network and your needs grow. Thinkst Canaries are deployed around the world, from Iceland to Australia, with some of the biggest names in the Silicon Valley using them right now to identify threats before they become company-ending breaches. If they trust their Canaries, I'm thinking that you'll love yours. Check out canary.tools/twit to get more information or to see them in action. For just $7,500 per year, you get 5 canaries, your own hosted console, upgrades, support, and maintenance for a full year. And just for the audience of the This Week in Enterprise Tech Twite Riot, if you visit canary.tools/twit, that's again, that's visit canaries.tools/twit, and enter the code TWIT in the How Did You Hear About Us box, you'll get 10% off your canaries for life. We're so sure that you'll love your Thinkst Canaries, but if you're not happy, you can always return your canaries within their 2-month money-back guarantee period for a full refund. Again, visit canary.tools/twit. And enter the code TWIT in the How Did You Hear About Us box to receive 10% off your canaries for life. We thank Thinkst Canary for its support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Folks, it's that time, my favorite time of the show, where we get to bring in an expert to share some knowledge with the Twilight Riot. We welcome back Vijay Balasubramaniyan. He is the CEO of Pindrop. Vijay, thank you for joining us again.
Thank you for having me.
Now, the last time that you were here, you explained to us how your technology was able to identify fraudulent calls. Not just fraudulent calls, but also detect things like the time that it would take for an automated system to switch over to a human. And you could detect patterns so that you could tell one of your clients, hey, we think a fraud storm is about to hit your telephone tree. You've sort of evolved that a little bit. And, I know there's still a lot of Americans who are smarting from tax day. You have been doing research into preventing phone fraud for taxes. Tell me a little bit about that.
Absolutely. So, you know, one of the things is we want to become experts on anything related to voice, any kind of fraud that's perpetrated on the voice. And though our focus has largely been on the enterprise side of things, we thought about how do we also help individual consumers like you and I, right? And so one of the things that we started looking at is what are the kinds of scams that individuals like you and I get constantly bombarded with. And given that it was tax season, right, starting January 1, we did a whole bunch of research on trying to see out of all the robocalls that people get, how much of that is tax scam and, you know, what can we learn from that tax scam? And it's really, really interesting what we found. What we did first in order to fundamentally see what kind of calls individuals like you and I get is similar to the canary system that you just advertised about. We have a phone honeypot that we set. We have the world's largest phone honeypot. We call it our phony pot. Essentially, it's a bunch of phone numbers that no one is supposed to call. And we've set that up such that if it gets a call, invariably that's a scam call. And then we started collecting those scam calls and start classifying them. So that phone honeypot itself, we have about 250,000 fake phone numbers. So that makes it one of the world's, I mean, it's one of the largest honeypots. And we get about 90,000 calls, about 90,000 phone numbers calling our system every single month. And that amounts to about 500,000 fraudulent calls coming into that phone honeypot. And based on that is what we did our entire analysis on the IRS scam.
The last time you were on and you were talking about people hitting phone trees, you had some very interesting software that was showing us how you could identify what regular activity looks like. And a regular activity would be a number calling maybe this number and then this number. But then you have these phone scams. And what it looks like is you have one number that suddenly is dialing every number that it possibly can. And it, when you put it into one of those big data analytics screens, it actually looks very obvious. Not so obvious when you're actually experiencing it. Take a step back now and explain to our audience what are the common tax fraud scams that you would get over the phone? How are they using that phone call to get information about me?
Yeah. So fundamentally, there seems to be three kinds of scams related to tax. The first one is essentially the most scary. It's a threatening call that comes to you and says, you owe so much in back taxes, and we need you to pay that amount. Otherwise, you're going to have law enforcement show up at your doorstep and arrest you. So, you know, that amount ranges, right? It's anywhere between $1,500 to $5,000. But they say that's what you owe the IRS. They call themselves, you know, the Federal Investigation Bureau for the IRS. And so they call in, threaten you with warrants and arrest, and try to steal money from you. The second kind is, being able to help you with your back taxes and the payment of it. That's the second kind of scam. And then the third is tax companies that are trying to get you tax relief. So these are the three big categories. But the one that's most nefarious and most troublesome are the ones that threaten you for the fact that you owe the IRS taxes.
Right. And unfortunately, we've all heard those stories of someone who sends in a check for $4,500 thinking that he or she is putting themselves in the clear. And of course, they've just given that money away and they still owe money to the IRS, which that's special. That's special.
Yeah.
Vijay, it strikes me that this specific work that you've done with tax fraud, is a great extension of what you do every day at Pindrop, which is, and you told me this last time, your primary job is to think like a criminal. You try to think like the people who might be defrauding an organization. And so you put yourself into their shoes. You say, well, what do you have that's valuable? What might they want to go after? How might they go after it? And that's the first step. Before any of the technology kicks in, before you track any of the numbers, before you look at any of the big data analytics, you need to know, what is it that I can steal from this company? And how, if I were actually trying to do it, how would I go about doing that? So every time you bring up a use case, and let's use tax season as this, how do you do it? How do you sit down with a bunch of people? Do you have a couple of former fraudsters on the payroll who might be able to help you with this? How do I put myself into the mind of the bad guy?
Yeah, we did it really simply, right? So what these guys were doing is calling our phone honeypot system. So it's a massive set of phone numbers that are getting these phone calls, and fundamentally determining that, you know, some calls of them are for IRS scam, right? Because we collect those calls, we transcribe those calls, and then cluster them. And so we know a set of those calls are coming for the IRS scam. And so what we ended up doing is we took one of the phone numbers that got called, and we obviously got the phone number that called us. And then we called them back with one of our researchers, and we spoofed the phone number that they called. And the interesting thing is that was important, because if we just used any generic number to call them back, they actually didn't pick up the phone, right? Like we got a very, very strange message which said this phone number was disconnected and things like that. But when we called them back with one of the phone numbers that they called in our honeypot, evidently they have a list of their own, right? And so they have a list of people that they're trying to call, and one of them happened to be in our honeypot. So we use that phone number, call them back, and actually engaged with the fraudster. So we did step-by-step instructions on what they asked us to do. And so we fundamentally have that entire thing transcribed. So we have the entire call audio as well as we've transcribed it. But fundamentally, we know exactly what they're doing, because we followed them step-by-step until the very end.
We've got Roebling in the chat room who makes a very good point. This is just a variation of the phone message you get: you just won a cruise, call us back to find more details. That's essentially what this is, except, as you mentioned, it might be one of those three types of frauds. Either they're threatening you, they're telling you that there's a way out of the problem, or they're just informing you that you need to provide them with information. So, all right, there's going to be people who say, well, if you get scammed, you're stupid. It was your fault. I mean, I would have spotted the scam. Of course I would have known that it was a scam. I wouldn't have done something so foolish. You get to see it at an entirely different level, because you're not talking about one scam. You're talking about thousands, tens of thousands of scam attempts.
Yep.
Why, Vijay, is it so successful?
Okay. So in this particular case, right, what they did is they called, and they refused to let our researcher ever keep the phone down. So they kept saying, you know what, if you hang up the phone, we can't say that you're any longer engaging with us, which means you're in violation of some IRS law, and therefore what you need to do, and then we'll have to send the police to you. So their entire mode of operation was to keep us on the phone, constantly keep telling us how dire the consequences would be. And then when we went driving to the ATM, they were with us. When we pulled the money out of the ATM, they were with us. When they instructed us to go to Walmart and get a MoneyGram, they were with us, right? They refused to ever let us go. And, you know, even the way they do it is actually really interesting. So, if you take a MoneyGram, they were constantly asking us for information. So they asked us for SSN, all of those pieces of information. So they're not only doing this IRS scam, they're collecting a dossier of information on us through this entire call. But when we asked them for any information, they said, no, you don't need to know us. In fact, if you look at the MoneyGram scheme that they asked us to send it, all we had to do was give a first name, last name, and a city. And within 10 minutes, apparently, they get the amount, right? In our case, they were trying to get $1,900, but they were doing that. And so they were constantly pressurizing us, constantly using the threat of arrest as a way to get us to comply. and never getting off the phone. And, you know, when they do this at such large scale, so even our honeypot has gotten 8,000 calls since Jan 1st, each of them one of these guys trying to scam someone, right? And so we've gotten a lot of calls. We've analyzed those calls, but we managed to be on the receiving end of one of those calls with a researcher. And the kinds of things they said, the way they abused us, it was insane. In fact, if you go listen to that call, you actually feel bad for the researcher, knowing fully well that they know what they were getting themselves into.
Wait, do you have those calls online?
We can send them to you.
Okay. You know what? We can't do it for this episode, but please send them to me. We will have you back just to play those back, because that sounds like that's fun. That's an episode in and of itself.
And you probably have to censor some of it. It's really abusive.
We'll right? do a late night episode of Twi. And, you know, it's the real deal. Okay. So we've got B-Tree in our chat room who actually brings up a very good point, which is what you're describing. It's game theory. Escalate. Never let them say no. Always find a way for them to say yes about something, and that's your entry. That's your way in. Yep. This is social engineering, and that's why I find this topic fascinating, because this is something every enterprise needs to be concerned about. If they're not teaching their layer of employees that deal with the public how to spot social engineering, then they're not doing their job. In fact, on TNT yesterday, they were talking about, there was a Wired author who invited a couple of DEF CON hackers to hack his life. And one of them actually used social engineering to get his real email address and then personally identifiable information. And you can see it happening. They actually filmed it as it was happening. And you're thinking, okay, that representative didn't do a bad job. They were trying to be helpful, as they were trained to do, but they could not pick up the signs that this was phone fraud. And so every time I hear someone say, well, you're just stupid, I'm thinking, no, these people are just very good.
Yeah, they are. And you know, you can imagine, right? The conversion rates for any of these scams are really small. So they get a lot of practice, right? They keep trying different scripts. And even in this call, right, I think the initial portion of the call was with one person. As soon as they knew that this researcher was on the hook, seemed to show signs of complying, they got another person who was much better, much more polished, knew what to say. And so they have a hierarchy of who's better at what. And we see that even in the enterprise world, right? You have the initial guy, and we classify that into different rungs of the Godfather Mafia, right? Because I'm a big fan of the Godfather. So, you know, you have the soldiers who do, you know, some of the early grunt work. Then you have the captains or the capos, the soldatos who do the grunt work, the capos who do, you know, a little more work. And then it's the Don who goes after the big account with a lot of money in it, uses some of the best distortion technologies, uses all the capabilities to social engineer a call center agent, and he uses everything under the book, right? He uses flattery, compliments people on their voice. If that doesn't work, he uses anger. We have a guy called the Mad Russian who starts screaming in Russian as soon as, you know, a agent doesn't comply. And we have had one agent get so worked up because she's being graded on how well she talks to the customer. Hearing this guy start screaming at her, she started reading out every bank account transaction after the other. And then, you know, she didn't give him very much, but then he called back saying, you know what, I'm online. And then the call center agent says, no, I can't see you logged in. And he says, okay, I'm going to read out my transactions one after the other. It is me, right? And the call center agent says, okay, it is you. What can I do? And then he wires money out. So these guys are phenomenal at what they do. So the fact is that just imagine a fraud tool that has a human behind it using all the fraud capabilities like voice distortion, spoofing, and then you have the complete intelligence of a human behind all those tools attacking you. And when you think of man and machine coming together to attack you, you start realizing how social engineering itself has evolved over time.
Vijay, I'm going to bring in my co-host in just a bit here, but I do have one very simple question that we got from the chat room. I want to credit the person who did it. B-Tree, no, Java Man, I'm sorry. Someone did say, how is it that they find your number? I mean, I can understand them going down a telephone tree of a corporation, But if you have your number unlisted, how is it that the scammers are getting your number to put into their database?
Yep. So we've seen them do a variety of things. So, you know, what we've seen them do initially is they call, I mean, like the good news with numbers, unlike email IDs or anything else, is they're structured. So, you know, you want to call everyone in Georgia, you start off with 404. You want to call everyone in this county, you say 404-385. And then what I'm going to do is call 404-385-0000 to 9999. Which area codes have more density of people? Which area codes have more, which exchanges have more of that exchange used up? All of that is public information. So you have extremely structured data, and you know the utilization on that data. So you know your pecking order. And so the initial call for a lot of these scams is a silent phone call. So they call you, and in fact, I'm sure you've faced this, right? You pick up the call, and you say, hello, hello, and there's no one on the other end. When you look at that call, it's a random call. Right. And, you know, over time, you can actually see this. So in our own honeypot, we see initially when there's a scam coming in, they'll call you from all kinds of area codes. Then they'll start zooming in on your area code. So, and I can see this particularly with my phone number. I have a New Jersey phone number. It starts off with, you know, 908. So I don't get calls from 404 numbers, even though I'm in Atlanta. I get calls from a 908 number, which has a similar exchange as mine, and only the digits are changed. And when you get to, when you speak to the other person, they're like, oh, I'm calling from the local branch, or I'm calling from the local IRS chapter. They're saying things to make you believe that they have the ability to send something locally down to you very, very quickly. And that's the power of, you know, having a structured phone number and the fact that it's extremely easy to then go after particularly pocketed areas.
Actually, Vijay, you just, that was a light bulb moment for me, because I get dozens of scam calls. And my phone actually auto blocks them now, but I can go down the list to see what calls I got that it did not even try to answer. And they're always the 202 number that I have on my local cell phone. They, you know, it's never one of those weird international numbers. It's never from another area code. It's always from 202. That's exactly what they're doing. It's playing on that part of the human psychology of, well, if this person's closer to me, I guess I could trust them.
Yeah. And you know, the propensity for you to pick it up too, right? Like right now, when I get a 404 call, I'm like, is it somebody from my office, or is it someone that I forgot to store the contact address information? Okay, let me just pick it up, right? And all they need is that hook.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. All right, let's go ahead and bring in my my co-host here, because I see them in the monitor over here, and they're both kind of like, Chibert, Curtis, neither of you would ever get scammed. You're way too intelligent to get scammed. Are you?
I'm actually pretty rude.
Okay. That helps. That helps. I know that you have no problem hanging up on people.
No, not at all. Actually, though, I like what Radio Rod said in the chat room. And I'm actually going to read this. I get an incoming call, and the caller would say, I need to make a payment, and wanted me to verify personal information. I would say, I don't give personal information out to an incoming call, but I'll look into what you're saying and then call the official number on my statement. That sounds like a really, really good plan, folks.
Right. Yeah. Always do the callback. It's the whole, I mean, we've kind of gotten trained to do that on emails, right? We'd never click a link. We don't trust something that someone's sending to us. We'll go out and verify it ourselves and use the original, the official site. But, you know, Vijay, it's interesting. We won't do the same thing for a phone call.
Nope. And that's the thing, right? The email medium is asynchronous. So it gives you time to think. It gives you time to say, okay, you know what? Let me go check who this person is. A phone call is synchronous. It's in real time. It's happening then. It has you on the hook. And that's why it's so powerful, right? It's so hard. Now that you're on the hook and someone is telling you, you owe taxes. And I have friends, like I have a friend who's a computer science student at Georgia Tech. So really, really, you know, I mean, like you can't imagine someone like that getting scammed. But she got a call and the call said, And this was at 3 o'clock in the morning. So it woke her up and the call said, we are from the immigration services and there is something, there's a problem with your immigration record and you have to pay $3,400. Otherwise, tomorrow morning, you're going to have a bunch of people come to you and deport you. And she went, she tried calling all of us. It was 3 o'clock in the morning. No one picked up. She called her parents back in India. And they said, what is $3,400 compared to your education?
Oh, no.
And she paid it. She's a master's in computer science at Georgia Tech. That's no joke. Yeah. And she paid it because, you know, what's $3,400 compared to your entire life in front of you? And this is what why a phone call is that effective.
Right, right. Because it does feel like right now. And Curtis, I want to bring you on this. When we talk most often here on Twiat, we're talking about protecting ourselves digitally, finding a way to protect our networks, finding a way to firewall off the information that we've stored digitally. But maybe you can answer this: is there a lot of attention being paid in the enterprise world on the management level to social engineering, to someone coming in via the phone tree, because that is far less protected than our networks?
No, there isn't. Oh, sorry.
No, I was going to say, in my experience, it's worse than that, because I have talked to a number of people who are in the pen test business. They have devised pen tests for social engineering, and many of their clients will not authorize pen tests for social media hacks because they are worried about causing distress to their employees when they fail. And so they would rather not make their employees feel bad than to let someone go through a pen test, show them where their errors are, and show them how to fix it. So in many cases in the enterprise, it's not just that they're not taking it seriously. They're aware that the problem exists, but they are willfully choosing not to deal with it, except in the most generic ways. You know, things like hanging posters in the break room, similar to the old... hang in there with the cat. And if that's the biggest social engineering protection mechanism that you have, you better hope that you have some really cute cats hanging on your wall.
Chiebert's in our private chat, and he's saying how, pen testing over the telephone via social engineering is actually part of every cyber warfare exercise. And I believe Raphael Mudge, who we've had on the show quite a bit, he actually does offer an exercise in that now. And it sounds as if, Vijay, let me get over to you. It sounds as if an enterprise should be training its employees just as much as they're training their IT folk to recognize digital attacks. But that doesn't happen, right?
No, it doesn't. With organizations that have call centers, right, and there are call centers, call center agents who there's quite a bit of turnaround with them, right? There's quite a bit of attrition. They don't get trained on many of these calls, and it's only after we've started making them aware that slowly that is changing, slowly but surely. But a lot of them are woefully unaware of, you know, the fact that they aren't speaking to a fraudster, and you can see this, right? This is true at some of the biggest organizations. So if you look at the two hacks that happened recently against the director of national intelligence and the director of the CIA, it all happened over the phone. Called in, got through the account over the phone and completely took over the account all over the phone, right? And so a lot of these enterprises don't train their employees well enough to handle a call on the phone. And we've seen this even at Pindrop, right? We have employees here who tend to get a call saying, hey, you know what? Like my CFO gets a call saying it's me calling and he needs to wire money out, right? Or an email of a similar sort. But the call is what tends to get him more riled up. So those are the kinds of things that you need to train your entire enterprise to say that it's very rare. And in many of these bigger enterprises, they actually will call and say, I am technician number so-and-so, and try to get an elevated set of responses because they claim to be not just a customer or not just someone, but a technician of that particular organization.
Oh, I want to throw this one to Curtis. We need to end the show, but this was a really good point. Beatmaster Curtis, he writes in the chat room, call centers have a huge burnout rate. We know that. People don't last very long. So there are a lot of companies who are thinking, why would we invest time to train them to recognize social engineering calls when they're probably going to be leaving in a couple of months? And I think that's a valid concern. If you're not paying the people well, and these people actually have access to all the information that someone would need to destroy the data of one of your customers, you've got a natural tension in your enterprise. Curtis, is there a way around that?
The way around it is to change your thinking about it. I mean, let's be very cold-hearted about this. If you do recognize that the people in your call center aren't going to last very long, that means that you're basically treating them the same way you would treat, office furniture. They are just a short-term asset. But let's look at other short-term assets. What if someone told you, because you're driving your trucks so far, the tires are going to wear out in 6 months? It wouldn't make sense to say, well, if they're going to wear out in 6 months, we might as well just go to the dump and buy ball tires anyway. Because you know that if they blow out on the highway, the results could be catastrophic. Well, the same is true of your call center employees. Even if they're going to be with you a short amount of time, if they mess up, and if they mess up in just the right way, from a financial perspective, it could be catastrophic. So why not go ahead, as part of their onboarding, include the training for social engineering? It adds very little time, very little cost, and can pay off huge dividends.
Right. Several people in the chat room are saying, wait a minute, you're giving all this power to an uninformed, low-paid employee? That's maybe not a good idea. I can't think of one very good example of maybe a good way to do this. Zappos. In Zappos, every employee who signs up with the company, doesn't matter if you're going to be an engineer or an executive, actually, no, it's all flat now, so there are no distinctions, you have to spend, I think it's a month, taking calls. So everyone has to go through the call center, and it does allow people to see that side of the business. It's like, wait a minute, that's the area that's actually touching the customers. So maybe I should have intimate knowledge of how that actually works. Unfortunately, we are out of time. I could go on forever. I was just I was talking to my TD Brian, and we're looking for those calls because we just want to hear them. We want to find out what your researchers have been doing, Vijay. We've been speaking with Vijay Balasubramaniyan. He is the CEO of Pindrop. Vijay, an absolute pleasure to have you on. I can't believe we took this long to have you back on the show. We're going to do it again. What I'd love to do is to get a panel of a couple of pen test experts and just go around and talk about protecting everything from the firewall to the phone tree. Would you be interested in coming back?
Oh, absolutely. I always have fun on this channel, and you have very, very knowledgeable guests, and that always is a absolute thrill.
Well, Vijay, if you could, please tell our audience where they can find Pindrop, where they can find you. And this is your plug time. You've absolutely earned it. Let us know how we can protect ourselves and our networks and our enterprises with your services.
Absolutely. So, Pindrop provides a call center anti-fraud and authentication solutions. So you can go find us at www.pindropsecurity.com. My Twitter account is at VJ_voice. So, definitely tweet, reach out. And absolutely looking forward to hearing what your viewers have to say.
Again, that's Vijay Balasubramaniyan. He is the CEO of Pindrop. If you are looking for a way to protect yourself from the social trap, you need to check out Pindrop. Again, Vijay, thank you for being on. We'll have you back again on This Week in Enterprise Tech.
Great. Thank you.
Of course, we need to thank everyone who makes this show possible, and that includes my co-hosts. I wouldn't want to do the show without them. These men are true scholars, they're true friends, and they're true geeks. Chiebert, I know you're getting packed. You're getting ready to head over to Las Vegas. I'll see you there in just a few days. But what else do people need to know about the Geek in Paradise?
Well, the Geek in Paradise is eating the learning curve on a whole bunch of embedded platforms. But it looks like I've managed to find someone that is willing to not hold me to a different set of standards So I may actually instead go for a computer science advanced degree.
Ooh. So wait, will we be having to call you Dr. Chiebert soon?
Maybe.
I will say this. Go ahead and throw theology in there because the robes for theology doctorates are beautiful.
Yeah, I can imagine. But, you know, hey, I almost went into the seminary.
Me too.
Yeah.
Curtis, you are joining us at Interrupt, yes?
Why, yes. I'll be out there for the duration of the show.
Oh, fantastic. So what will you be doing between now and then?
Frantically packing up all of the radio gear here and getting ready to pay an airline a lot of money to help me transport it to Las Vegas. I have a bunch of interviews coming up for Information Week Elite 100 radio that's going to be happening following the conference. A lot of great interviews with executives from companies talking about their best projects and how they made them happen. A lot of good stuff there, not just from a technical standpoint, but from the standpoint of how to manage technology teams and how to manage projects within the enterprise. So keep your eyes out for the Information Week Elite 100 radio coming up soon.
Definitely one to look for. Curtis Chiebert, again, thank you for making this show so much fun over the years. Folks, I also want to thank you. That's right, our listener, our viewer, the loyal person, member of the Twit Army, the member of the Twit Riot who comes back week after week to watch and listen to This Week in Enterprise Tech. We couldn't do a show without you, and we want to make it easier for you to get the content that you love. Just go to our show page at twit.tv/twiet. When you see that picture of the big fat priest, just go down below and you can subscribe to audio, either an audio or a video version. Get it into the device of choice. Do you want the audio version in your iPhone so that you can listen to us on the way to work? Well, you could do that. Do you want a video version on your Android tablet so you can watch us at breaks? You can do that. Do you want the high definition video version on your Mac, your PC, your laptop, or your desktop so that you can watch us in all our HD glory when you get home? Well, you can do that. Again, that's twit.tv/twiet. Also, don't forget that you can follow me on Twitter, twitter.com/PadreSJ. If you follow me there, you'll find out not only who we're going to have on every show, not only will you be able to suggest guests and topics for future shows, but you'll also see what we do here at Twit TV when we're not on the air, and it can actually be a lot of fun. Don't forget that we do this show every Friday at 1:30 p.m. Pacific time. You could go to live.twit.tv and watch us make the show live. See how the sausage is made. That includes the pre-show, the post-show, and everything in between that gets cut out of the final version. And as long as you're watching live, join us in the chat room. It's actually a great place to be. It's interactive. It's a way for you to express your opinions on the show. Maybe your questions get asked to our guest live. And of course, it's part of the experiment that is Twit TV. Finally, thanks to everyone here in the studio who makes this show possible. To Lisa and Leo, of course, for supporting This Week in Enterprise Tech for so long. To Karsten, my super producer. And to my absolutely phenomenal, fantastic, good kind of guy, technical director, Mr. Brian Cranky Hippo Burnett. Mm-hmm. Brian, you killed it this week at NAB in Las Vegas. Hey. And I can't say anything bad about you for the show because that was impressive.
Uh-huh.
But aside from that, what else do you do here at the Twit TV network?
Well, I think our how-to show that we just broadcasted from NAB, Know How, keeps me pretty busy. So definitely check that out on Thursdays and on Mondays. You can follow me at @cranky_hippo on Twitter. And if you do, you'll see all the things that we did at NAB. And it was a lot of work, but it was a lot of fun. I think my favorite part was the PTZ cameras because I could spy on you.
I did like those. Although, yes, that was kind of creepy to look up and see camera pointed straight. They have to put lasers on the front of those so that you can see. Although then I'll just end up chasing the laser dot.
Oh, yeah. Who wouldn't?
Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit. Just reminding you that if you want to know what's going on in the enterprise, just keep twiet.